in a relevant way. Also, youth, if y'all want to go back with Missy, she's going to teach y'all today. So, all right. Brandy was telling me a story one time. How many of you are familiar with Beth Moore? Pretty popular female Bible teacher, really, really good, anointed teaching lady. She was telling me a story one time about how that Beth Moore received a call, and it came from a young girl or a young girl's mom, and this young girl had terminal cancer and wasn't going to be with us very long. One of the young girl's requests was that she'd be able to meet Beth Moore. She was a huge fan and admirer of Beth Moore and her teaching, and it started this dilemma in Beth Moore's mind and heart. She thought about how if she were to go and visit this young girl, how that she would get attached and it would matter. And when she did, barring a miracle, you know, go on to be of the Lord, that it would be devastating to her. You know, it's easy to overlook the needs and the hurts of the world whenever there's not a face to put with it. But that is kind of where Beth Moore was. But, you know, she's a woman of God, and she chose to go and meet the girl. It's another similar story about this church. It was in Germany about the time the Holocaust was taking place, and, you know, during that period, the church was near the railroad tracks that would haul Jews off to their death at these concentration camps. And it was like clockwork. On Sunday mornings, they would come by and they could hear the cries of these Jews being hauled off to a horrific death. You know what they did? It would come during the time whenever they would be singing, and when they would hear the train squeaking and the metal to metal, and they would hear the horns of the train coming, they would just begin to sing a little louder so they didn't have to, you know, deal with what was going on. And I know they were powerless to do anything about it, but, you know, the church at least could have prayed, you know, instead of just ignoring it. Sadly, that's what a lot of us do, is we ignore the needs and the hurts of the world and the people around us. You know, those two stories, those were people that were experiencing hurts and tragedies that they couldn't control. Now, there are some of us, and I'm one of these, who, because of stupid choices, begin to suffer and, you know, caused other people to suffer because of stupid choices. You ever made a bad choice? I mean, something you look back and say, man, that was completely and totally dumb. And then, you know, it started a chain of consequences, and you know, you could have prevented it had you not made that choice. Have you ever done that? You ever made some stupid choices like that on your own? How did the people around you respond to you or react? You know, sometimes people are very compassionate, and they understand that they could have also made dumb choices. But then you get some of these who are very pharisaical and religious, and they start saying, well, it's because of your stupid choice that you are here, and we're not going to do anything to help you. Sometimes we don't help people because the color of their skin is different, or their you know, economic background is different, or what we feel below ours. And for whatever reason, sometimes we don't help people. But the thing about it is that Jesus came to seek and to save those who are lost. And there's a lot of people who are hurting. You know, some who are hurting because of things that are out of their control, some because of dumb choices, but there's opportunities there to help that person and point them toward Christ. Brandy's going to play a video. I'll tell you a little bit about the video before she starts. It'll line up the scripture we're going to be talking about. It's a modern video, but recorded in black and white, I think, to capture the essence of it. It's also a foreign video, but it's really neat and it's really intriguing. You'll be able to get what is going on. Brandy, if you'll play that video.
Thank you.
so easy for us to misjudge based on outward appearance. I'm very thankful for the verse that God recorded in the Old Testament where it says that God judges based on what's inside, not outward. We sometimes judge outwardly. Did you notice how that nurse, whenever the biker guy brought the victim in, how that she kind of turned her nose up, looked at him, maybe she thought he did it, and she just didn't like him, you know? But then he's the one that actually saved the guy's day. You know, there are a lot of people out there in our community who have been beaten down by their circumstances, by society, sometimes by overly religious people, sometimes by people who are, you know, go to church but maybe are hypocritical, and you know, their circumstances have really beaten them down, and they feel helpless and hopeless. And you know, the help sometimes comes from unlikely places and unlikely people. And I want to look at a passage of scripture where Jesus teaches that, and it's found in Luke chapter 10. We'll start in verse 25, and it'll be up on the screen if you want to read along. I didn't send them out this morning on YouVersion, but it'll be up on the screen. Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbors as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this, and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" I'm going to stop right there, then I'll finish reading it. We'll come back and explain it a little bit. Back in that day, there was a written law, the inspired law, the Word of God, the Old Testament, what we call today, especially like the first five books, and they were, you know, it was etched in stone. It was God's Word. But then they had their oral traditions that sometimes lined up with God's Word and sometimes did not whatsoever. And that ultimately is what got them in trouble, was their oral traditions that they started viewing as higher than God's written and inspired Word. So in their time, they had an oral tradition that the neighbor was somebody who was just like them, somebody who thought like them, somebody who looked like them, smelled like them, and everything else. But Jesus is about to blow that out of the water. It's easy to love people that are just like you, isn't it? And it's easy to love people that think like you and don't challenge your thinking, and, you know, it's easy to love people when they come through that door if they've got, you know, a pocketbook and a checkbook and, you know, they smell good and they got it together. But what about the ones that has come through that smell strong and, you know, they need help and hope, but outwardly they're nothing like you? These guys, you know, that was not somebody they would see as their neighbor. But look what Jesus says in verse 30. In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by the other side. So too a Levite, so when he came to the place, he saw him and passed by the other side. But a Samaritan," and some of you may know, some of you may not, Jews and Samaritans were arch enemies. Jews hated Samaritans. Jews were like, if you helped to bring birth to a Samaritan into the world, you were just like, you were just scum, you know, if you even helped with that. That is how bad they despised Samaritans. You know, they thought they were very elite, and the Samaritans were like lower than the scum on the bottom of a, you know, stagnant water barrel or something. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, you know, you got to figure, you got two people coming along, and at this point, probably, you know, they're expecting, well, the priest didn't do anything, the Levite didn't do anything. In their minds, possibly they're saying, okay, he's going to say, now a Jew, a common person like us. It blew their mind, I'm sure, when Jesus said this. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and he saw him, he took pity on him. One version says that he was moved with compassion. this is not like the compassion you see when you see a TV commercial, you know, and you see the needs and stuff of children or whatever need it is, and you shed a tear and you can just kind of walk away. That's not the kind of compassion. This word in the original language is he was driven to do something because of the deep compassion that he had within himself. That is what made the Samaritan do what he did in verse 34. Verse 34, he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who, look, he can't even say the Samaritan, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. Kind of feel bad for that Samaritan to a degree because he has a big heart, he wants to help, and yet he's looked down on and misjudged by people around him because of a preconceived bias, a prejudice that was placed on him. But let's look at some of these men in these passages, some of these people in this passage. You know, we see 4 different people. We see this man. Now, the man is a lot like us, or you may know somebody like this man in your life. The man made a downright stupid choice. It said he went down from Jerusalem or down to Jericho, and it literally is a dangerous road. It's 17 miles and it is a downward descent, but it is a very dangerous road. That would be equivalent to like some of you ladies dressing up in a, you know, very provocative dress, very short, you know, and walking through some dangerous streets in Atlanta with pocketbook, with just cash, you know, spilling out of the pocketbook. That is equivalent to what this guy did. That road was known to be a very dangerous road, and he made a dumb choice to travel down that road alone, and as a result, he became a victim. Now, keep in mind, too, as we read the story, as we go through it, you know, the Bible says that they stripped him. So he's naked. You can't identify him. You don't know if he's a Jew. You don't know if he's a Samaritan. You don't know if he, you don't know who he is at this point. And that's going to be important as Jesus shows us some awesome principles. What is amazing about the stories of Jesus, especially the parables, are that they are like a mirror. They're like a mirror that we can look in as we read these stories, and we can see a lot about ourselves. But what is amazing, too, is they are also like a window in which you can look up and see something about God that we may not have known until we read these stories that Jesus tells. So these parables, these stories, they're like a mirror that reflects who we are. You look in a mirror, and if you have a blemish, you can't deny it. It shows you that. So that's what some of these stories are like. They also show you the good as well, but then the most important thing, they're a window that enables us to see something about God, and that's my prayer for this passage. You can see something about yourself, and that you can see something about God. You couldn't see the guy. You couldn't tell who he was. You know, was he a Jew? Was he a Gentile? Was he Samaritan? Who was he? You know, he had made a dumb choice. There are people in your lives, and you might even be at a place right now that you're suffering because of a bad choice. You may know somebody that you love or a friend who is suffering because of bad choices. They need somebody to be a neighbor to them. It doesn't matter what color they are. It doesn't matter what color you are. There are people hurting around us. So there's that man who made a dumb choice. The next group of people is these robbers. They were victimizers. They were opportunistic feeders. They took advantage of this guy's dumb choices and made him pay as a result. Then you have the priest. Did you notice what the priest did? It says the priest came along, and as he came along, he saw the guy, but he passed by on the other side. Now, a priest is a person who would offer prayers and sacrifice on behalf of God's people. A priest is somebody who was supposed to fight for his people. His job was to fight for those who could not fight for themselves at that time. A Levite's job, he did the same thing. He came along, he saw it, he went on the other side. A Levite's job was to assist the priest. He was one that was supposed to help fight for the people. both of them passed by the other side. They're a lot like what Beth Moore could have did and ignored that girl's request to come and see her, to get involved. She didn't have to get involved. These priests were a lot like the people in that church that just...